Hi all, let's talk about AZ 303 exam cramp. There are two parts for preparing this exam. One is how to prepare, what should be the plan. I have created another video for that. You can check it out. I'll put a link. It talks about the 3 weeks plan and the resources to be used and the practice tests, etc. for the exam. Here in this one, we will focus on what to remember and what to cramp for the exam. So let's get started. First thing I want to you remember is about ports. There are so many questions in the exam which are related to this. So you need to cram it. You need to know port 80 is for HTTP, 443 for HTTPS. Likewise, 3389 is TCP. It's not for RDP. 22 port is for SSH. 53 is for DNS server, normally listened on port 53. And 21 is for FTP port. So you got to cram it. There will be direct, indirect questions related to that. There is no way around but to cram. Now let's talk about storage account. So storage account, one important topic is about redundancy option. So these are the four redundancy options: local redundancy, zone redundancy, geo redundancy and read access, and geo zone redundancy access. I have another video if you want to go in detail to talk about all of these. I'll put a link for that. But for the exam cram point of view, these are the things you need to remember. You need to remember the durability of these. You need to remember availability of read request and availability of write request and number of copy data maintained separate nodes. I have tried to put same color. For example, this GRS and GGRS have the at least 16 nines, right? And the same way we have wherever the commonality is there, I have tried to put the same color. So this you need to cram for the exam. Continuing to storage account, there is a type of storage account and what are the usage for that you need to remember. So you need to remember that there is one standard general purpose VP storage account, then there are three premium storage account, and then there are two legacy storage account as mentioned at the bottom. And what are the storage supported for them, what are the redundancy option, and what are the usage? There could be a lot of questions around that. And I have again tried to color the common things in this. That helped for the exam cram. So that way you can see. For example, LRS, local redundancy storage option is available for all kind of type of storage account. So I have marked that as green and highlighted in all the colors. So that way you need to spend some time and cram this for your exam. Other few things to remember for storage account. So storage account, when we create, they are public by default. That means it need access with password. And by default, they provide secure transfer. By default, they are HTTPS. And there is another tip about to remember is cross-region resource sharing, which is CORS, is supported by the storage. As you know, CORS is HTTP. A feature that enables a web application running under one domain to access resources in another domain. But for the exam, you should remember that it is supported by Azure Storage. Moving on, Azure Files. So what we need to remember here is, what are the kind of two performance? It provides standard performance, which are this number we need to remember. And it has a premium storage, which is again, the latency, bandwidth, IOPS, this we need to cram. And now there are characteristics of storage options, again redundancy wise, right? So this we need to remember, like what kind of characteristics you need and what redundant storage makes sense. For example, if you want if premium performance is required, then it will be local redundant storage and zone redundant storage. And also at the bottom it is showing how the durability changes when you go on the higher redundancy. So these are the things you need to remember about Azure Files. So key roles to remember, there are different roles. You can see a lot of details around that, but these are key roles to be remembered for the exam point of view. Global admin or enterprise admin can implement AD Connect. In the same line, Azure AD global admin account is needed for Azure AD tenant, and an enterprise admin account for on-premises Active Directory. So these are the role needed if you want to implement AD Connect. Now second is, who can add subnet to VNet? Only owner or the network contributor can add. Even security admin cannot add it. So these are kind of things you need to remember. Network contributor role has the ability to manage load balancer based resources. Now, there is another very important topic is assigning permission to resources. Like who can assign permission to others, right? So now network contributor or security admin or even the contributor role do not have the privilege to assign permission to resources. So in order to do that, the user must be granted either a user access admin role or an owner role. So these are the two roles to be there, access admin role or the owner role. And this access admin role also known as admin delegator. So this can, then what's the difference between owner and the access admin role? So access admin role can assign access to other, but lower than owner, as it won't have the access to all the resources like owner. So owner is a like superset. Owner does a admin delegator, which is called user access admin role. Even though it can assign, but it cannot assign to everything because the owner has the, now there are some tip about the RBAC scripting, RBAC read only. So RBAC, there are some tip about the RBAC scripting, like what does that start backslash read means? That means it can read everything under this. And if the star is on the other side, on the next level, Microsoft.support/*, that means everything can be accessed, whether it is a read, write, whatever permissions are there, but under Microsoft support. So everything can be accessed under that. So these are the two things you can use, because there might be some questions like, okay, they might have given a script and this could be */read. So what does that mean? That means only read access is given for that. Now, another thing which we need to remember, a relation between resources and region. So many times there are questions, can this resource we have to be within the same region or different region? So I have summarized those things. The recovery service vault is a region-wide service and the following things have to be in the same region. For example, web app and app service plan, they have to be in the same region. You cannot have two regions and we can keep web app in one region and app service plan in another region. Same way, if you are putting a virtual machine, should be in the same region of network interface and virtual network and the virtual network gateway. All of these need to be in the same region. Same way, virtual machines and load balancer or application gateway need to be in the same region. Application gateway is nothing but L7 load balancer, as you know. Now about the vaults, virtual machine and recovery service vault need to be in same region, virtual machine and Azure key vault should be in same region, storage account and key vaults in the same region. Then another thing about regional is VNet peering can be done between different region. And there are some global resources which I have listed here. You need to remember that. And the last line, functions, ACR, servers, resource group are not global resources. So need to remember all of these things as a CRAM. And then there is a tip about databases. If databases are same server and the elastic pools are also on the same server, the database can be removed from one pool and then added to another pool. So remember that. Something about resource naming. Some resources need to have exact name. You cannot change it. For example, Azure Firewall Subnet, it has to be called this. Boston Subnet has to be called it. And some naming need fully qualified. A web app has to be fully qualified. Web app function, storage account, fully qualified means it has to be a unique name so that it can be accessed over the network. High availability. This is like a simple mathematical thing, but I have seen questions around that. So we got to remember, right? So for example, if our downtime can be 14.4 minutes per day, what does that mean? It means it's a 99% availability we are looking at. So VM SLAs, so virtual machine has their own SLAs. I'll not go through all of these, but this you need to remember for the exam. More on virtual machines. So availability set, you cannot place virtual machine in availability set after the deployment. So once you deploy an availability set with the number of virtual machine, you cannot add the VM after that. VM scale set includes a load balance. Does not cost anything on top of VM. Now disk on VMs. On virtual machine, you will see two disks. One is operating system disk, 127 GB, and there is another one is a temporary disk, 4 GB. and data on this disk gets deleted when a virtual machine is stopped and started. Now, there are questions on what is the difference between shutdown and restart of VMs. So there are two ways you can do it. One is through portal and one is through VM itself. When you do it through portal, the VM gets deallocated from the physical infrastructure. So once they start it, it may start at the same host or a different host. So what does that mean? You would lose public IP in this case. If you have a need to restart VMs from the portal, you should use a static IP address. But if you are restarting or stop starting, but if you are restarting or the VM through the VM itself, then the status in this case changes to stopped versus deallocated. And the public IT and the public IP address stays, and you can start this from the portal. So once you have stopped it from the VM, you can even start it from portal. So these are the tricky questions around this, which you need to remember. More on VM. To add network interface, you need to stop the VM first. You cannot add a network interface not running VM. And VM auto scaling in scale set. So if you are multiple rules and about scale out, the scale out trigger if any rule met. But on the other hand, scale in triggers if all rules met. So, and there are some definition that what is duration and cooldown minutes. I'll let you read it and remember this for the exam. Now talking about virtual network, about subnet. Now talking about virtual network, subnet is mandatory. It is created by default but can be changed. Within a VNet, but in different subnet, VMs can communicate. So these are the two tips you need to remember for subnet. Then about NSG Network Security Group. As you know, it is used to control the traffic like a firewall. But firewall control fully qualified domain as well. But Network Security Group is IP based. So it is a separate resource. And this gets attached either to network interface or to the entire subnet. So if it is accordingly, it can impact the VM. If you are attaching it to network interface, then it will only affect the VM. Or if it is entire subnet, or it can affect the or control the entire subnet. So these are the things you should remember. And about VNet pairing, data transfer is charged both outbound and inbound. And no device subnet gateway is needed. But comparing to other methods of connection, it is costly. And it can connect across subscription. If both VNet are classic deployment model, you cannot connect through VNet. And in case you want ping to work, peering should be done both ways. Thank you. And then there are some questions about authentication and verification methods. You know, there are like two kind of authentication, multi-factor authentication or self-service password reset. Now there are methods around that. For example, the question could be, hey, can I use, for example, the question could be, what could be a primary authorization or secondary authorization in this case, right? So for example, if you see SMS could be a secondary authorization in both MFA and SSPR. So, but at the same time, if you see there is no email address, so you cannot use email address as secondary or primary authorization for any of the method. And also there is no app code. Authenticator app can be used for the secondary authorization for both MFA and SSPR. And then there is something called rate limiting. It is a suspension of notification that occurs when too many are sent to a particular phone number, email address and all. So there is a limit which is set up. SMS, no more than one SMS every 5 minutes. Voice, no more than one voice call every 5 minutes. Email, no more than 100 emails in hour. So you can remember that. Node balancer, there are different schools. So basic, remember it is free, but it has no SLA. The question can say, hey, I need a SLA, but I need a cheaper one, right? So that means definitely the basic is free, but you cannot do. You need to go for the standard. It's a SLA of 99.99 and NSG are mandatory. Here, what we need to remember is what are the some resources which have the capability to stream platform logs. Those are log analytics workspace, storage account, and event hub. Passport does not get into parameter file. So there could be question There are like an ARM template. There are like a parameter file. Can we have password in that? No. And second is, do I need a resource group to deploy ARM template? The answer is yes. Azure Functions provide three plans, consumption-based, app service plan, and premium plan. Here, consumption plan is cheapest, but it does not provide sticky session. And on the other hand, premium plan is costly. So when we need to provide a cost-effective sticky session, we need to go up for app service plan. And to enable that sticky session, we need to go to function app configuration. Then under general, we need to go to AR affinity and enable that. On the logic app side, there are questions around throughput. By default, it can execute 100k action per 5 minutes. If we need to increase it to 300k per 5 minutes, we need to go to workflow setting and change high throughput as on. And then the last one we going to talk about is Azure Service Bus tiers. The Azure Service Bus comes into basic, standard, and premium. And these are a few things we need to remember. For example, the topics are not available in basics, but they are available in standard and premium. So with this, we are done with all the exam tips for AZ 303. Hope you liked it. Hit like, subscribe, and see you in the next video. Good luck for the exam. Thank you.